We're now looking at parables that I have grouped under the heading, The Consummation of the Kingdom. And we ended 2 weeks ago. We were looking at the parable of the 10 virgins, or the 10 maidens, or the 10 bridesmaids, variously translated. And that parable occurs only in Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 to 13. And it comes immediately after the parable of the faithful or unfaithful servant, a parable that urges the disciples to steadfast faithfulness during the Lord's absence in light of the uncertainty of the time of the Lord's return. Now, that parable ends with a depiction of the unfaithful servant being severely punished at the master's return. And then the parable of the 10 virgins links to that judgment scene by the opening of then, or at that time. It says the kingdom, I'll read this again, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. For when the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flask of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a cry, here is the bridegroom, come out to meet him. Then all those virgins rose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. But the wise answered, since there will not be enough for us and for you, go rather to the dealers and buy for yourselves. And while they were going to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was shut. Afterward, the other virgins came also, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered, truly I say to you, I do not know you. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour. Now, as I said in the last class, the kingdom is analogous to the situation that's described in the parable of the 10 virgins, in that only those who are ready to meet Christ when he returns will enter the delight of the consummated kingdom of God. Just as only those bridesmaids who were ready when the groom came, they were ready, and then therefore they entered into the joy and the feasting of the wedding feast. Only those who are ready to meet Christ at his return will enter into the joy and the delight of the consummated kingdom. Those who are not ready will be shut out. They'll be shut out of God's presence, just as you saw there. R.T. France, commenting on this parable, he says, the effect of the story then is to stress the need to be ready for a coming that will be in an unexpected time. Furthermore, the story suggests that among those who to all outward appearances were all in the same category, 10 girls sleeping together by the roadside, there is in fact a fundamental division between those who were ready and those who were unready, and that this division has eternal consequences for their contrasting destinies. That is, either sharing the feast with the bridegroom or wailing unavailingly outside the closed door. So this is the picture that we get. He goes on and he says, in the parable of the bridegroom, if you remember weeks ago, we started out with the parable of the bridegroom in their midst in Matthew, in Mark chapter 2, and in the parallels in Matthew and in Luke. And in that parable, Jesus' present ministry was compared to a wedding feast. Remember, he's the one, he's the reason for the feasting. So his present ministry was compared to a wedding feast, with all the associations a wedding feast has with the kingdom of God. But here it's the future or the consummated kingdom that's compared to a wedding feast. And let me read you what David Wenham says about that. Wenham says, this could at first sight seem surprising and even contradictory, because Jesus speaks of his present ministry in terms of this is the kingdom as a wedding feast here. He is the bridegroom who has arrived. He's the reason for the feasting, for the celebration, so it's not fitting that they would fast. And then here it's the consummated kingdom. He says, this could at first sight seem surprising and even contradictory, but in fact, a characteristic of Jesus' kingdom teaching is that he sometimes speaks of the kingdom being present in his ministry, and yet at other times he urges his disciples to pray, your kingdom come. But see, you're already tuned into this, right? Because we've gone through the now and the not yet. And that's why I tell you, this is a fundamental aspect of New Testament theology. It's all in the writings of Paul. It's all here. But he goes on, he says, the explanation of this is not, as some have suggested, that the gospel record has mixed up and confused what Jesus said, but rather that Jesus did indeed believe that in one sense, the revolution had come in his ministry, and that in another sense, it was still to come. The growth parables help to explain this, which we've looked at. Sowing and reaping are part of the same process and yet quite distinct from one another. So I wanted to address that in case that was coming up or that hit you. Now the parable of the 10 virgins, it doesn't say what constitutes readiness in terms of Christ's return. It's key to be ready. I mean, we have to be ready because you see that has major consequences. That's the difference. Being ready or unready. But it doesn't really develop what constitutes readiness. But elsewhere, it's clear that readiness involves steadfast faithfulness, continuing to live in light of the conviction that Jesus is Lord and Savior. That's what readiness is. See, steadfast faithfulness, living like it's true that Jesus is Lord. It's not just something we say and don't really believe. It's not something we just mouth, but that we really trust that he's Lord and we live according to that confession. That's what it means to be living faithfully. A life lived that way, that's a life that is prepared for the Lord's return, whatever that should occur. You're living that way, then you're ready for the Lord's return whenever that should happen. And the fact the foolish virgins, the fact they were unable to borrow from the wise, now that could be just simply storytelling. You see, parables, that could simply be, it's possible it's simply dramatic storytelling. But it also may point to the truth that one cannot piggyback on the spiritual readiness of another at Christ's return. The fact your husband or wife or mother or brother or uncle or aunt is a faithful Christian, you don't get to claim that. You will stand individually before Jesus at that time. So it may point to that. It could be dramatic storytelling, but it also could have a deeper meaning. Now, some people try to make something out of the allegedly selfish conduct of the wise virgins in not sharing their oil. But that misreads both the situation that's presented and it all in the parable, and also misreads how parables function. You see this so much. People seize on little things and try to blow them up as the meaning of the parable is clear. And I think this is just a misreading of things. Let me read to you what Snodgrass says, Klein Snodgrass, in his book Stories with Intent. He says, such charges betray an insensitivity both to the situation depicted and how stories function. If the oil the wise brought for their lamps was divided with the foolish, all the lamps would go out and the celebration could not proceed in the dark. More to the point, these complaints show a dismal failure to understand how parables work. Parable and reality are not connected with equal signs. Parables are not direct pictures of reality and do not claim to portray life as it should be. They only partially map the realities they seek to reveal. So to seize on this thing where you have here, well, they didn't give it to them. You know, they're selfish. That's really the point. You shouldn't be selfish. No, you've just taken off on something that is, I just think is not the way that parables are to be read. Now, the fact that the virgins slept while they're waiting for the groom, that carries no negative connotation. You see, there's no negative connotation in the parable because both the wise and the foolish slept. And sometimes people see, oh, they slept. They weren't, It has no negative connotation. Both of them slept. The wise had prepared beforehand. You see, they had prepared beforehand, so they're sleeping in no way diminish their being alert. You see, which is the meaning of the word watch there, the sense of the command watch in verse 13. R.T. France, he says, during that delay, all the girls go to sleep, not merely the foolish ones. So readiness does not consist in living in a constant state of red alert. Life must go on in the interim, and the provision for the parousia, the coming of Jesus, depends rather on having made preparation beforehand so that one can safely go to sleep, secure in the knowledge that when the time comes, everything will be in place. You see, so there's nothing about the sleeping. No, they are ready. What happens to them? They're ready. Hey, he's here. Okay, we wake up. We're ready. The others weren't ready. Those who are ready, what? They go into the joy of the feast. You and I are ready in our life lived consistently with the confession, Jesus is Lord and Savior. So we live that way. We're faithful. We are living a bowed life, a life that says, yes, he is king, and the king's will is to be done in my life. Okay, that's the, so when that is the case, you go to sleep, get up, you work, you do these other things, but your readiness is from that faithful living. That's, I think, something that's important. All right, next to the last parable. There are really two in this category, and I've got one more after this. But it's the parable of the talents and the minas. Okay, talents in Matthew, and there's a parallel in Luke. Really, it's a parable that's told at a different time. You have the parable of the talents in Matthew chapter 25. Verses 14 to 20, in the parable of the minas, it's sometimes translated pounds. In Luke chapter 19, verse 11 to 27, these are variations of a parable that Jesus told at different times. You see, so he tells the parable one way here in Matthew, and then he tells a variation of it at a different time in Luke chapter 19. Now, some scholars reject that suggestion. They claim that, no, he only said the parable one time, and the difference is that you see they're really a later alteration of the single original parable that Jesus told. You see, so Jesus said X, and what you're getting is X and some kind of morphed form Y. Okay, instead of no, Jesus said X and Y. Now, I like the way that R.T. France puts this matter. France says, it is remarkable how resistant some New Testament scholars are to the possibility that Jesus, in the course of several months or even years of public ministry, may have used and reused similar material a number of times with different audiences for different purposes. Any preacher could have told them that this is the most natural scenario in the world. I remember Jack Lewis saying, if Jesus only told something one time, he'd be the only preacher to ever do that. You see, this is just perfectly natural to me that he would take, then he would change it and adapt it. And so that's what I think you're seeing in these two parables that we have in the parable of the talents in Matthew 25 and the parable of the minas in Luke 19. Now the parable of the 10 virgins that we just looked at, the parable of the 10 virgins, it speaks of the kingdom in terms of being ready to meet Christ when he returns to consummate the kingdom. The parable of the talents, it begins immediately after the parable of the 10 virgins, right after that, and it continues the reference to the kingdom with the opening words in 25:14, for it will be like. You see, so he's still talking about the kingdom, for it will be like. And the parable in Matthew 25:14-30, it's about, all the parables. It's about a very wealthy man who's going on a long journey, and this person entrusts large sums of money to three of his servants or three of his slaves. And to the one he gives 5 talents, to the other he gives 2 talents, and to the third he gives 1 talent. Now, a talent, this was originally, started out as a unit of weight. But because of, a weight of gold or silver. But by the first century, it was a unit of monetary value. You see, like dollars. It was a unit of monetary value. And a talent, 1 talent was equal to about 6,000 denarii. You say, well, that doesn't mean a whole lot to me. Well, a denarius was a standard day's wage for a day laborer. So 1 talent was equal to 6,000 standard wages for a day laborer. In other words, it would be about 20 years of salary for a day laborer. assuming a day laborer will work about 300 days a year. All right, so that's one talent. So this guy's got a lot of money. Okay, and he comes and he entrusts 5 talents, 2 talents, and 1 talent. And the fact the money was allotted to each servant in the parable according to ability, it shows that it wasn't given for safekeeping. Anybody can do that. It was allotted according to ability. It wasn't given for safekeeping, but it was given to be used to create a profit. And that would have been understood by the servants in Matthew, as is evident from the fact that the first 2 servants traded with the money. They understood. They understood what it was intended. He comes and he gives them this money. And the purpose is not to simply keep it. You see, it's not to simply keep it safe. But to use what I'm entrusting to you to make a profit. In fact, this purpose is made explicit in the version in Luke. In Luke chapter 19, verse 13, the master tells the servants, engage in business until I come. Okay, this is implicit understood in the version in Matthew, as you see from the two servants who took it and traded with it. It's made explicit in the version in Luke. Now, regarding the potential for increase, I thought this was interesting. Craig Keener, in the InterVarsity Press Bible Background Commentary, he says, those with sufficient capital, see, in this world, not a lot of people had a wad of money you could just give out to lend. It just wasn't a world like that. Now, if you happen to be somebody who had a lot of money, well, that money was valuable. And so he says those with sufficient capital could invest it at a profit. For instance, they could lend it to money changers who would use it to turn a profit and give them a substantial share. Lending money at interest was also profitable, given the exorbitant interest rates of the period, although Jewish people were not to charge interest to fellow Jews. One patron is reported to have lent to an entire city at roughly 50% interest. Because most people did not have capital available for investment, those who did could reap large profits. So we have this very wealthy man going away. He gives 5 talents, 2 talents, and 1 talent. The intention is that they are to take this money and invest it and work with it and increase this person's holdings, gain profits by it. Use this that I'm giving you profitably. That's what they were supposed to be doing. Well, the master, he returns after a long absence, and then he calls the servants to account for their handling of what he had entrusted to them. Gives them the money. They are to use it. He goes away for a long time. He comes back. And then he calls them to account for how they had handled the money that he had entrusted to them. And he's pleased with the first two. The first two servants, he's pleased with them. They had doubled his money by putting it to work. Now, Keener remarks, he says, doubling one's investment was normal, and the servants should have been able to accomplish this. So however that may strike us, he's gone a long time, but in this economic environment, having that money, being able to double it, was something that would have been expected. So both of the first two, they were able to double the investment. And the master, he commends them both. He promises to bless them, and he invites them to enter into his joy. But the third servant, he then comes forward and he says, Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow. You understand what he's saying? You didn't sow that. You're just taking the stuff. Reaping where you didn't sow and gathering where you scattered no seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours. You see, this is this guy's angle. This servant hid the master's money to keep it safe, rather than use it to gain a profit as the master clearly had intended. He didn't do what the master wanted. He went and hid it to keep it safe rather than do what he intended. And then he blamed the master for his unproductive inactivity by saying that the master was so ruthless in matters of wealth that he was afraid of putting the money to work. He was afraid of risking putting the money to work. So you're such a tyrant. You're such a money grubber. You're the kind of person who will steal from people. Well, I was afraid of that. So here, all I did was I just went and hid the money. Here you have exactly what you earn nothing, but I kept the principal safe for you. Well, the master's having absolutely none of this. The master says, but his master answered him, Matthew 25, 26 to 30. His master answered him, you wicked and slothful or lazy servant. You knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I scattered no seed, did you? Well, if that's the case, then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers. And at my coming, I should have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one who has 10 talents. For to everyone who has will more be given, and he will have an abundance. But the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the worthless servant into the outer darkness. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. He calls this servant wicked and slothful, or wicked and lazy. The opposite, you see, of the first two. Good, faithful. Wicked, lazy. And he turns the servant's accusation back on him. Servant says, listen, you're really to blame. You're such a money-grubbing, wicked person that who could chance putting your money at risk? So here, take what's yours. He turns that back on him. He said, look, if you really thought that I was so ruthless in matters of wealth, you would have feared making zero profit. If you really thought I was this kind of person, you would have feared making zero profit, and at least you would have made a safe investment with a bank for minimal gain. Craig Keener says, the smallest possible investment providing interest on a savings deposit could not have endangered the deposit. It would have been as safe as burying the money. You see, something else is at work here. If that was the case, he says, if you were really so fearful that I'm such a tyrant when it comes and so ruthless in matters of wealth, first off, you should have been afraid of making no profit for me. But then, you see, you could have taken the money and safely have deposited it with bankers, and I at the very least would have received that minimal interest. So something else, you see, is working here. It would have been as safe as burying the money. And the fact that this person didn't do that, this servant didn't do that, it exposes his accusations against the master to be rationalizations, as does the conduct of the other two servants. The other two servants were free to do that. They went ahead and did it, right? So this is a rationalization that this person is making, trying to justify his defiance of what the master wanted. The master clearly wanted them to use the money to earn a profit. This fellow refused to do it, and he tries to justify it by blaming the master. And something else is going on, and you see what's really going is that this person has absolutely no commitment to the master's desires, no commitment to the master's affairs. He does not care that the master intends for him to earn a profit. He doesn't care about that. So what? That's what he wants. I don't want that. So he has, that's the problem. That's what is exposed here. He doesn't care about the master's interests. The other two did. They did what the master intended. This fella, wicked and lazy, hides it and then tries to block the blame with some lame justification that the master simply pierces and shows what's really going on. Now, the servant's one talent, that servant's one talent's taken from him, see, which probably symbolizes the finality of the situation and the severing of the relationship with the master. The fact that he had entrusted him with this and now he takes the one from him, you see, that symbolizes the finality of it and the severing of his relationship with the master. And the fact that it's given to the one who had 10 talents, the one who had most effectively accomplished the master's purpose, that's meant to reinforce the blessing of faithful service. It is not intended to convey anything negative about the other faithful servant. It's simply to reinforce that faithful service is blessed. The worthless servant is then cast into the outer darkness, which is an image for hell. You see, for example, in Matthew chapter 8, verse 12, and it's described in classic hell language. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And as I've said, you know, whatever you want to do with the concept of hell, you can't drain it of the reality that it is absolutely, utterly horrible. It is the last place any human being would want to be. And Jesus speaks of it repeatedly, as you see him doing here. Now, the point is, again, the need for disciples to be faithful during the Lord's absence. The Lord has ascended, and he's coming back. And during the Lord's absence, you and I as disciples are to be faithful in getting on with the Lord's business. As the servants in the parable, as they were entrusted with wealth, Jesus' disciples, we, as participants in the kingdom, we've been entrusted with privileges and opportunities. R.T. France says, when the master goes away, it is their responsibility not to wait in pious idleness. I love that phrase. Not to wait in pious idleness, but to get on with the job he has entrusted to them. He will leave behind great potential, but he expects that potential to be developed through the faithful discipleship of his people. Our Lord has gone and has entrusted to us privileges and opportunities, and he expects us to function like we really believe he is Lord and Master. Because our Lord and Master has given to us things and has a call on us that we are to live and to be a certain kind of people. Well, France concludes his review of this parable. He says, the parable of the talents, therefore, develops the theme of being ready by spelling out a little more concerning what is expected of disciples in the period before their Lord returns. Just as the slave of 24:46, Matthew 24:46, was commended and rewarded for being hard at work when his master returned, so this parable calls followers of Jesus to responsible activity, or in the imagery of the parable itself, to maximize one's potential for the benefit of the kingdom of heaven. And just as the five wise bridesmaids were not caught out because they had already made sure of their oil supply, so followers of Jesus are expected not to sit and watch, but to make preparations. Our readiness consists in having faithfully and boldly discharged our responsibilities as disciples, whether they have been small or great. It is the master who allocates the scale of responsibility. It is the slave's responsibility to carry out faithfully the role that has been entrusted. Now, that's our lives as disciples. You and I gauge and see what are our privileges and opportunities in serving in the kingdom of God. And we have that, and then we go and sanctify all that we have, using it for the glory of God. So you may be in a position where you have certain opportunities. Everything that you do, the master has gone away and entrusted you. We, as his people, need to be about doing what the master has called us to do. That will vary. We will all be in different situations and circumstances, but we have different privileges and opportunities. And as disciples, it is our responsibility to be faithful to the Master and to use those things to his glory and to the growth of the kingdom, the blessing of the church, and all of that. This is what we're to do. Now, that doesn't mean, of course, when you talk like this, you have to say, it doesn't mean that one achieves one's salvation by works. And I think we're so afraid of that we refuse to sound this other side, that we have responsibility, that we are to be people who work. You see, rather what this means is that true faith, genuine faith, is visible. It produces works, as I have said ad nauseum. Saving biblical faith is not mere intellectual assent to certain propositions, but it's the yes of one's total being. You see, that's when somebody comes and say, well, do I think these things are true? That's good. That puts you in the valley of decision. Now the question is, will you surrender your life? I'm talking about your life. I don't know how old you are. You're 15, you're 20. That is from now on. Will you surrender your life in service to Jesus so that when you understand that Jesus calls you to something and He wants you to be a certain way and to do something, your answer is yes, Lord. You see, that's it. That's it. It's the yes of the total person. Dan Wallace in his Greek Grammar Beyond the Basics, he says, both James and Paul would agree, I believe, with the statement, faith alone saves, but the faith that saves is not alone. Now, Douglas Moo, in his commentary on James, the one in the Pillar commentary series, he's got two, one in Tyndale, one in Pillar. Douglas Moo says, Christians need to continue to pay attention to the warning of James that true faith is to be tested by its works, and that only a faith that issues in works is genuinely saving faith. You see, there is such a thing, as I've said many times, Luke 6:46, when he says, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and don't do what I say? Why do you utter the sound, Jesus is Lord, but you live like you are? Anybody can say Jesus is Lord. The question is there truth behind that confession? If there is truth behind that confession, it cannot but change your life, right? How can you go from saying, I don't believe Jesus is Lord, to now I'm convinced Jesus is Lord, and have that have no effect on your life? Well, that's not possible. If it has no effect on your life, then the confession is bogus. Anyway, he goes on. He says, James recognizes that Christians continue to sin, so he clearly does not expect 100% conformity to the will of God. But how high must the percentage be? How many works are necessary to validate true saving faith? James, of course, gives no answer. But what we can say with confidence on the basis of James's teaching is that the claim of anyone who's totally unconcerned to lead a life of obedience to God to have saving faith must be questioned. This guy who says, listen, I don't care what you want, but I'm going to take, I know you want me to use this money for profit, but I don't care. I don't care what you want. I'm going to stick it in the ground. I'll give it back to you. Okay? I'm not going to act in accordance with your status as my master. Well, that person doesn't have the relationship that is necessary. You see, so you apply that to what are we doing? When we are Christians, Jesus is our Lord and we serve Him. I've shown you before in a number of different contexts, maybe even earlier in this class. I just didn't want to go back and hunt and see if I have already. But you know Dietrich Bonhoeffer, that young German pastor and seminary teacher who was executed by the Nazis in his book, The Cost of Discipleship. He says, cheap grace is the grace we bestow on ourselves. In other words, it's not biblical. It's something we've created and the religious world runs with. Because then it says, well, you can't call me to righteousness. You can't rebuke my sin. That's being mean. That's being judgmental. I'm saved by grace. I'm saved by grace. And that is a twisting, you see, a twisting of biblical truth. The cheap grace is the grace we bestow on ourselves. Cheap grace is the preaching of forgiveness without requiring repentance. Baptism without church discipline. That the impenitent cannot continue in the body of Christ. It is not loving to let that go on. Do you understand that? When you let somebody who's living in impenitent sin continue in the body of Christ without calling them to repentance, and if they obstinately refuse being disfellowshipped, the function of the disfellowshipping is not only to cleanse the body of Christ, but it is to call that person to repentance. We think we know better than God. You see? No, that's not how you do it. You just let them hang out here. You see, but anyway, he says, baptism without church discipline, communion without confession, cheap grace is grace without discipleship, grace without the cross, grace without Jesus Christ living and incarnate. Costly grace is the kingly rule of Christ, for whose sake a man will pluck out the eye which causes him to stumble. It is the call of Jesus Christ at which the disciple leaves his nets and follows him. And that's what's being talked about here. That's what Jesus is saying in parable after parable, that as I'm away, you have a responsibility to be faithful to me and to be about my business, to treat me as I am the Lord you confess. And I think that's very, very important. Now, there's the version in Luke 19. There are a number of differences in the version. Jesus tells the parable in Luke chapter 19, and it differs from the version in Matthew chapter 25. It differs in a number of ways. There, the man who's leaving, he's a nobleman. He's a nobleman who's going to a distant country to have himself appointed king. So he said, that's one of the differences. And he calls 10 servants. The other we had 3. Here he calls 10 servants, and he gives each one of them a mina. The other fellow gave 5 talents, 2 talents, 1 talent. This one, 10 servants instead of 3. And he gives each one a mina, which was 3 months' wages for a day laborer. So it's still a significant amount of money, but it's much less than what you had there. Now, the nobleman's potential subjects, that's a group that's distinct from the nobleman's servants. He calls his 10 servants, he gives them each a minor, but then the nobleman's subjects, a distinct group, they hated him. So he's going off to have himself appointed king. His subjects hated him, and they sent a delegation after him to lobby against his appointment as king, but he was made king anyway. So you have the servants, and you have his subjects. He goes off, gives them the minas, and you have his subjects follow him and say, hey, this guy shouldn't be king, but he's made king anyway. You see? He then returns. He returns and he calls his servants to account for how they had handled the money, the mina, that he had given to them. And only 3 of the servants are discussed. Okay? It's not because the 7, you know, you can't... You don't just go up and say, well, 7 now, what are we going to say about the 7? Well, the 7, why? Only 3 of them are discussed because that's sufficient, you see, to depict the nature of the accounting. It's a parable. So he has 3 of them are discussed in the accounting because that is sufficient to show the nature of the accounting. And the actions of these 3 and the judgment of those 3, it parallels that of the 3 servants that you see in the parable of the talents in Matthew chapter 25. Though the negative judgment in the parable of the mina is the negative judgment there on the wicked servant is expressed simply in terms of the mina being taken from him. He went into more detail about that in Matthew 25. Here it's expressed simply in terms of the mina being taken from him. But as I said, that probably expresses or symbolizes the finality of the situation and the severing of his relationship with the master. So it's not some insignificant thing. It is showing that he's no longer with the master. He's cut off from the master. Okay, so this minute, but it only says that part and doesn't elaborate. Now, after reckoning with his servants, the king in the parable of the miners, he orders the enemies. You see, those subjects who hated him and who opposed his kingship, who went over there, he orders that they be executed before him. That they be executed. Now, this version of the parable here in Luke, with this nobleman going and you have these people who follow him, this has some definite parallels to what happened following the death of Herod the Great. Now, Herod the Great's death is usually put at 4 BC. There are a few people who want to argue and put it down in like 2. But most everybody would say that Herod dies in 4 BC. And Herod willed his mini empire to 3 of his sons. Herod Antipas was given Galilee. Now, this is the Herod who had John the Baptist beheaded and who tried the Lord Jesus before sending him back to Pilate. And then Herod the Great, he left Judea and Samaria, those regions. Galilee goes to Herod Antipas. Judea and Samaria he gave to his son Archelaus, and he bequeathed to him the title king. Well, when Archelaus, when he journeyed to Rome to have his position over Judea and Samaria approved by the Romans, a delegation of Jews and Gentiles followed him to lobby against his appointment. So you see, I mean, there is such a clear parallel here historically. Now, Archelaus's rulership was nevertheless confirmed by the Romans, but with the title ethnarch rather than king. And Snodgrass remarks, he says, although no explicit report of Archelaus's vengeance exists, Josephus refers to, quote, old feuds and Archelaus's brutality. Now, it's hard to believe that Jesus' audience, when he's telling this, that they wouldn't see an allusion to Archelaus, especially given that Archelaus's palace had been in Jericho, which is the city that Jesus had just left in Luke, when he's telling this. Now, if that's the case, then that part of the parable then serves as an indictment of unbelieving Jews for resisting the Messiah as if he were Archelaus. You see, it's an indictment of them. Here is the king, and you're over here arguing against him, so you're treating the Messiah as though he were Archelaus. You see, so that's something that what winds up happening then? See, the condemnation that they get, it's expressed so graphically. So what happens to them? They're slaughtered. And it's expressed so graphically, you see, to underscore its gravity, and it represents the condemnation of all who reject the king. You see, so here we have the king, the Messiah, in a parable showing that those who reject him, and he depicts their rejection of him as king in what? An awful slaughter. You say, oh, my Jesus would never do that. Have you read Revelation? Why do you think he's doing this? Why do you think he's telling them this? Because he's trying to alert them to the gravity of the danger they face in rejecting his messiahship. He can't paint it more graphically. He can't paint it as though it's more intense. You see, so that's what he's doing. You treat me and reject me as king, and this is the consequence, because there is only one way to be reconciled to God. It is through what I'm going to do and through faith in me. You see? All right. Next week, Lord willing.